There's not much difference in that. It's not me.
It's okay.
Okay, are you done fighting? So, I guess, let's start with the questions, if there's nothing else. So we have something about energy landscapes.
This cable is too short, but I guess it's this plot that someone discussed.
So this is just an example, and why it happens to be like an L there is not so important. Well, it probably is relevant for a number of cases. So let me just explain what this is. So, if you understand this part, this is the number of native contacts. Basically, if you take contacts, it's what residues are in contact. So, it's a fraction of all this, of the contacts that are native. So, native means that they exist in the folded structure that you have from physical structure where they got from. So, this is a very, very small protein. And this is the residue ratio, so basically how compact it is. That's. So, if we have an extended chain like that, it has higher duration, and if it's compact, it has a smaller duration. So, it clearly is, and this third dimension, the population, energy or free energy, but basically, you have lower free energy if you get some sort of population. Can see it. And then the Danes have done a long one. They used, in those days, this whole supercomputer alone for 1 month and run a simulation of a very, very small protein. So what you can see here is that maybe it starts somewhere up here where it's actually, this is not one confirmation, but basically have no native contacts. It has something which is just randomly, small fraction of the contacts are there anyway, just by random. But it's sort of extended.
And it seems like it has a kind of, it can get compact without having any
native contacts.
But then you also have many compact conformations that have an increasing amount of native contacts.
They're made more and more similar to the
native structure, and then you have the native structure here is something that's very close. Well, the most lowest energy, lowest free energy structure is something that's very close to the native structure.
When you say native, does that just mean it's defined by the
Yeah, so in this case, I think it's by either case along with random R, so that's the.
Okay.
So that's. Yeah.
So in this case, that's the. I don't know, remember if I put in G, but it's very, very small, so it's basically a small hydrophobic packing of a couple of residues. I think it's like 29 residues or that.
There has been suggestions that you have like nucleation size for folds, basically some starch folds first and some other parts fold ahead. So you have kind of, you have to get the two sheets together first, and that happens. Like, and I guess you would basically see that of something here, and you would have like how half contacts are here are fulfilled in all the cases very frequently, but you don't really see that in this case. And it could be because this protein is just too small for that. So this is what I mean, the core nucleation apparent.
Otherwise, how
do
you see it? What would that look
like? I guess you would see, you would actually see it here more like, because you have a lot of native contacts. You would have things that have some native contacts, but it's not compact.
Because if you assume you have a long string like this, and you want to fold it up, so if it has like some parts that go like this part should be together, and still be extended, you would look at that. Then it would later come back together and look at this. And that would be apparent. You maybe have half the context correct, but
but still high regeneration because it still will not be folded. And that is not received. So you basically have, at least in this case, you have a collapse of everything first, and then you reshape and get the correct contacts. Because this is basically as compact as this one, but it's completely wrong contacts. So the collapse is, at least in this case, seems to occur first, and then the native contacts are found later. But it could be a bit. The problem is you can't really do this in of much bigger proteins because that takes too long time. Okay. Next question was. Yeah, so they have the lattices. So that's. Wonder if I have some pictures. No, I don't really have that. Right. So basically, I mean, this is not maybe so much used and longer, but it used to be, if you want to. Let's still large. So basically, how do you want to represent a protein if you want to do it in a computer? And basically, all representations some have represent every atom as a ball, and they have some kind of connection between the different atoms. And we have this molecular mechanics type of method that is up here somewhere that has basically one atom, one ball per atom. The early versions did not have the hydrogens there, and therefore you only had the polar hydrogens. Now they think they have all hydrogens. But you don't have, and then you have strings springs and angles that connect it, but you have basically bonds to connect them. That is basically represented as a spring. You will learn much more about this in the physical chemistry course later. So, but that's this kind of the picture we have. It's, of course, it's still a simplification because we know that if you would take quantum mechanics into account, we would have any electron clouds, and we have different things like that that are quite different. But this is what I would call a molecular mechanics type of force field, because you have an atom here. And of course, it's continuous because basically they are every atom has a XYZ coordinate, so everything has a XYZ coordinate. So there's no limits in the space. You can do the same thing. So for instance, today there is a simplified force field who only have two atoms per residue, so it has one atom representing this alpha and one side chain. Maybe it has two or sine side chains, but you have much fewer atoms. Certainly, that doesn't really represent a real protein, but it's a simplification that might be useful because, of course, you save a lot of computation time by ignoring 80% of the atoms. It's one force field called Martini nowadays that people use for simulating these things. So, and that means, of course, if you save 90% or 80% of the atoms, you probably can speed up things at least factor 5, and probably it can be squares, it can be even factor 25 or something like that. You're at least one order of magnitude faster. So people use that, and I use different type of simplifications here in the different histories. This is Michael Levitt's early work from the 70s, and Chiraga did work in the 90s, and other people on this later. So this is just, but it's all in three dimensions. Every atom can be in any position, and you have springs that connect these atoms, or these balls together. But you can get down to, a common wing way to describe this is actually do it by torsion angles, which fragments can be. So basically, you do not represent the protein as XYZ coordinates, you instead represent as torsion angles. You assume that every bond length and bond angle is fixed, and you have the rotations around the bond length. And this is, of course, it is a clear simplification, because you only have, for the backbone, you only have two variables per residue instead of 9 or 10, 9. So yeah, and you can get the alpha coordinates. And of course, and basically you can describe all
possible conformations that are realistic, because you know that this bond length will always be 1.08 angstroms or 1 plus minus 0.02 or something like that. It never really varies. You don't have to describe a situation when two atoms are next to each other in a bond that are 10 angstroms away from each other, because it never happens. So you limit your search space by having fewer variables. Of course, it's also more complicated because you really can't move everything in between, so you really can only move in this dihedral space. It's not in Cartesian space, you can just assume that everything can move. Cartesian space has a force that interacts. So lots of the mathematics gets complicated, but there are methods to do it. So you can do simulations in this dihedral space. These fragments is basically a similar idea. I mean, you work in dihedral angles, but you maybe work even with bigger part of fragments you put together. Like in Rosetta, so basically you can have 3 or 4 backbone conformations together, or even 9 or even longer, and you keep these and you put them into your coordinate space. But the basic, because these are overlapping, so basically the freedoms are basically phi psi angles and maybe something describing the side chain. And you can have the side chains, you can go everything. You can have full atom side chains, you can have Rosetta inlet has come extended atoms, so you have like one or two atoms or balls per side chain. David Jones, I don't know exactly how they had the flag fold. That's something different. So then, the simplest models that people offer simulating proton folding is just the square lattice, normal square lattice. You basically have the. Oh, you can even do it in two dimensions. You can have. Assume that proton looks like that. So this is a two-dimensional picture of proton. Of course, it's not very good for representing whole proton, but you can learn things about it. So there are, of course, this is so simple. So if you have a small proton, you can calculate all possible conformations. It's just to enumerate them all. And you can actually, so you can decide what are the rules for, so people ask, if you have, very, very simply, you only have two types of residues. You have hydrophobic and polar, and maybe what sequences fold to specific structure and which sequences do not fold to specific structure. So people done a lot of studying very fundamental description of physics ways of viewing it. It's not very useful for structure prediction, but it can be useful for understanding thermodynamical properties of protein-like polymers. My diamond lattice is a three-dimensional lattice that is slightly better to present than a normal square lattice. And then Skolnick here, particularly, and co-workers have done, had for a while they had left models that looks like that. So you have basically a, one simple one, I can't even draw it to it. You had the night moves, you go 2 step, 1 step, and 1 step. So you go from here to here. So you go like a knight on a chessboard. You have 2 steps in one direction and then 1 step in another direction. But the next rest will then be. Because this is gets more similar to what you actually observe in the protein than if you just walk in the squares. And they even use more complicated lattices later. And as I said, this is very limitation. This is of course very hard. You can only move to discrete space points in the space. But you can always do it here also. You can have only discrete torsion angles, could have one torsion angle for alpha helix, one for beta sheet. It's not very representative because you need to have the loops also. But the good thing here is that this, in the old days, computers were quite slow. It's very fast because you don't want things to collide. The only thing you can check is do you have an atom there before or not before. So you can have things that do very, very quick checks or simulation. And you can maybe make easy the pre-calculated defined modes. So if you have this one, you could move. This part over there, and have a change of structure from jumping from one step to another. It's not very intuitive to think about all the possibilities, but you can, if you do it carefully, you can just enumerate a lot of possibilities and do calculations very, very fast. I don't think anybody, there are a few groups still using that, but it's quite limited. So most people probably are using something like this nowadays, for jumping between these 2 steps. These things have been. Most of the 10 years or 15 years ago, when people used things, because it was
well, computers are faster, basically. Okay. So this is just what people done for. Well, I think basically all this has been done for structure prediction in some extent. On CTF. Okay, so this is Rosetta. So let's start with Rosetta. It goes a bit with Rosetta, I thought already. So the whole idea about Rosetta, Frag Fold and Rosetta was developed more at the same time, and Rosetta is probably the one that's used today a lot. So the whole idea is that you have, so assume your sequence starts here and goes all the way here. And for each fragment, you look in your database for sequences that are similar to your sequence, but you have a fragment of maybe, I think they have 3 and 9 angstrom fragments. So you do a sequence search, basically, using some method, and you find sequences that are not necessarily homologous, but they have similar sequences of the three. So you have, and then you look at the structures, what structures these have, and you can see here, for instance, in this case here, all sequences that are similar to that you have here, or some type of a loop. They're not the same loop, but there's more compact loops, more standard loops, but that's similar. Well, this one here is basically always a helix. So that means that you have a local preference of some kind of structure for every fragment. Well, some are maybe don't have a strong preference, some have a strong preference, and some have maybe a couple of different groups of preferences. So this one seems to be both a loop and a bit extended, so you can maybe custom somehow. This one is always extended, but in some cases it can be loop also. So it's not perfect, but you have some kind of bias. So you have some kind of bias. Yeah, so you do this, and this is like how to check the database, and I'm sure they've changed it since they published this paper. And one thing to think about is that these fragments are overlapping. So it's not, it's actually 1 to 9, and then 2 to 10, and 3 to 11. So they're not, so you have many fragments that overlap somehow. And then you basically have an energy term, and they have equations, so basically statistical potential for putting lots of these things together that are people done before. As I said before, they had the reduced representation. They are basically, I think they use the whole backbone, but use one ball for the sidechain. And then they start changing the simulating. So they basically try to say, let's replace this fragment here with another one and get a new structure. And then you does the energy get better or worse? And what is the difference in energy? And you keep doing this in the Monte Carlo fashion. So basically means that if the energy gets lower, you keep the change. If it gets higher, you have a sort of probability depending on the difference if you keep it or not. And you do this many times. And then you end up something else. This is some of your energy. And this is some structure representative. So the idea is also that all the structures that are close to this lowest energy are a bit similar to each other. While structures that are, so this seems to be like a mirror image that has a local minimum there, but you only find it once. This has missing one sheet, and this has one part unfolded, and this one is no sheets at all, etc. So they are a bit different. And then there is some other clusters. So basically, here is from one of the this is basically all the models that they generate. And this, I don't know why it's called forced to be. So set them up. And basically, this is the energy divided by atom. And in this case, you see the native structure down here, and the best conformation here, but you see it's quite flat. So what you can see is that there are structures here, you know, much worse than this one, but that are almost the same energy, but very difficult to separate energy structures from each other, maybe even this one. But if you do clustering, so basically you take similarities also, you can see you have a big cluster models here that are quite similar to each other, but well, this one probably do not have any other structures that are very similar to each other. This might be sort of this kind of outlier here that have a mirror image of it, or sort of mirror image of it.
Yes? I was wondering why would they have different Armstrong? Because don't you just using the same programs? Like, how do you get something?
So this measures the root mean square deviation. So basically, how much do the two atoms are separated in space? So you suppose the two structures on top of each other. So this is the native structure that is there.
Oh.
So you compare, you have a model, you compare how similar they are to each other. And then you take for every C alpha, that's what you hear. If there are two oxygen information from each other, you have the average difference. Right? You take a square difference and you take the root of the average.
Sorry, this is.
So RMSD is just measure that.
Oh, okay. So this one is like because you already know the what it actually look like.
Yeah, so this is the name. Yeah, otherwise, you're going to get.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so this is the contact predictions. So this is, if you really put on the mathematics, it's not really obvious why. I mean, there are some people that, you know, really sure the mathematics really explains this, but this is at least the way that people interpret this. So the idea is in these correlated mutations, is that you have this well-packed system. And then you have a mutation. And of course, one mutation will disrupt some interactions. So if this mutation doesn't kill you, or doesn't kill this protein, or the organism that contains it, it's quite likely that you get the compensating mutation. Yeah? This is the whole idea of correlated mutations. The problem is that if you look at this side of it here, the arrow up here, it's not the same as here. So you will have changes here also. To compensate, you will need to have a second change here also. Not only this change, we have another change here, where I guess Martin is being one. And that therefore you will see, it looks like that one is actually correlated with this one also. So they both should change. Only they are not in contact directly.
Sorry, can you say again what's indirect?
So basically, in the correlation, so if you look at the multiphysics alignment board, here, so if we take two positions, yeah? But these two are correlated, so this one changed from small to big, or this one from big to small.
Mm-hmm.
That could happen because this one changed from small to big, and this one from big to small, so they both changed something. But it could also be, these are also changed for some, in some way.
What is that green thing?
It's another residue from some other part of the protein.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Because it packs from many sides, and I mean, the other side of the side chain or whatever.
Okay.
So, of course, it gets more complicated when you have hundreds of these and all interacting with everything, but it's basically, so you could observe any correlation so that these two actually seem to change at the same time, although they're not directly coupled to each other. And so this is what we call indirect couplings. And you would think that you could just take the strongest coupling, and you would see things that would change. We just filter away because it's weaker. But it's actually because everything is coupled to everything else. It's not. It is not uncommon that you have stronger couplings between things that are not directly connected, but are. Well, I don't know how this actually would mean, but you have things that are A interacts with B and A with C, but you can actually have observe a strong coupling between B and C, or they are never in direct contact. And then, from old work on even earlier than that, that you can actually notice this. And the way to solve this problem is that you actually try to describe every coupling, every pair of interactions. And then you say, and then you try to say how strong are these couplings, and you try to find a set of couplings that are represent what you observe in these correlations. So you basically have a global model that describes everything. And then statistically, I mean, mathematically, this is not so easy because you have a lot of missing data, a lot of noise, etc. So there are problems with this where you use these POTS models, and this basically have to do an inversion of a big matrix, so which is not trivial. But the whole idea is basically there are these indirect effects. And this is what was discovered in I have the slide.
Somebody need to know the structure in order to know which one couple.
No, you don't need to know. The idea is you don't need to know the structure. So there was basically So this thing was known in for spin glasses, so basically very simple models of magnetic spins in the 90s. And then it was basically this guy over here that published a couple of papers about this in 1999, 2000. And nobody cared about it because nobody noticed papers. And then it was basically two papers in 2009. This is not exactly the same idea, but this idea here is but a similar idea. Mathematics, particularly this paper in 2009. I think it's in 2008 paper that sort of rediscovered this again and showed that it really could work to predict context very accurately. And after that, there are probably hundreds of papers out now. So it happened like 5, 6, 7 years ago the first time. And people start using these methods. And what you observe is that the contact maps that you predict are much, much better. So this is basically how contact map looked before. So this is the contact map I think it's described before. So we have the gray is the real contacts from the structure. And then the blue and red one are the ones we predict. And blue is correct, red is wrong. And you see basically all the contacts here along the diagonal. Most of them are wrong, there are a few here and there that are correct, but you don't really see any secondary structure pattern. But if you use this sort of these methods, there are two different methods here that are basically in this case more equally good. You really can see that these patterns of secondary structure pattern, you have these contacts over here, the contacts over here, that there are really strong couples, and you have this contact, you look at the structure, many contacts are correct, and then many more are correct. So it was really, and this is an area people worked on for 20 years before, or 15 at least, and really didn't do very much progress until this was realized.
Does that mean that they could win Nobel Prize or something? Well, it seems like a very important discovery.
I am not in Nobel Committee, so I don't know. It depends if someone thinks it's a good idea, but who knows? If I would decide, yes, but I'm not the one deciding. There are many things that are important. It hasn't really saved any lives yet. And Nobel Prizes are a bit strange because it always has to be one invention. Nobel Prize is not, so you have to make one detection, and it's, of course, it would be a bit complicated. Who would be, it was invented in spin glasses in the 90s, or the one that did it in 99 and nobody used, or there are 2-3 papers at the same time, and I'm sure it's complicated, but I'm sure it's going to most likely be discussed, but the other areas also. And yeah, then, so that was sort of the, that explanation again. So then it was my favorite slide, that's always difficult to explain. So basically, I mean, this is just example. If you have it's just to show that contacts in the protein are randomly distributed, because proteins are, of course, are proteins, so they have chains. So if the thing is taken by the beta sheet, this is the force. These two restaurants are contact, these two restaurants are contact, these two restaurants are contact. So in the content map, this will look like a diagonal like that, or like that, depends on if they are parallel or antiparallel. So you will have this diagonal. And what this plot shows here, but if we take a random dot here, a random position, you have to look at the 3x3 matrices around this. Basically, the question is: if you have a content here in the middle, how frequent is it that I see different patterns around it? Or if I have a content here, so in this case, I will have pattern looks like that. In the other case, I will have a pattern that looks like this, which has nothing in the middle. So then I just plot what are the most frequent patterns and divide them in this 9x9 grid into contacts and non-contacts. So basically, you have contact in the middle of. So if you don't have contact in the middle, the most frequent pattern is that you have no other contact either. But actually, that's the same if you have contact in the middle. The most frequent pattern is that they have no other contacts either. And then you have one contact here at every corner. Now one on the sides. Then you have two contacts here and these three corners. So this is basically as little contacts as you can think about in the 9 most frequent patterns. Here you actually also have these contacts are have one more contact is most common. But then you don't have these ones that are in the corner. These ones up here are less common. Instead you actually have these kind of boxes of 4 contacts. Then you have someone with one with 3 contacts, and then you have another with 3 contacts. So in particular, these ones in the corner are not that frequent.
They have only 2 contacts.
And if you put this together, so you basically say, how many contacts do I have? So this one has 1 contact, this one has 2, this has 2, this has 2, this has 4, this has 4, this has 4, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, this one has 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2. And you have to take all the 1s and all the 2s and all the 3s and all the 4s together and see how many there are. You get this plot. So if you have no contact in the middle, you see 99% or 97% has no other contacts. And then you have 1 contact have 2%. 3 contacts has about 0.2%. And then it falls down. It's exponential frequency. While if you have contact in the middle, you only have on the order of 8% of that have no other contacts. And the ones that have 1 more contact are equally common. If you add them all together, of course there are 8 options of these. So each of them are only 1/8 that's common, but together they're 8 times common. And if you have 3 contacts that are also about the same amount, but you have of course many more options of 3 contacts, you have to have 1 contact. And then even if they're a bit more common. And then it's only, and basically every group here is equally frequent until you get to basically a completely full matrix that is less frequent. So you have basically all 9 contacts. So this is just basically that contact likes to be close to contact, and this is, if you look at this contact map, it's obvious to see this. So if you have a contact map like that, you see that it's not like randomly plotted like that, there are contacts that are like this. So and of course this just illustrates that this is something that computers are really good at doing. We don't look at it 3x3 matrix, we have an 11x11 matrix. So many more options. But this is all the computers are made. I mean, this is image recognition that is actually what we do. So what we do here is basically we pick content and then iterate a few times. And I think this is quite. So we start with this one. And we basically we want to have contents next to each other. So these kind of contacts here are kind of most likely wrong, but these ones are actually quite close to each other, so basically we keep on populating these areas here. And you know, the first one, you get rid of some of these, you get rid of this one, for instance, not there anymore. And then the next layer, and you get rid of more of these, you get more and more here. you have more here, you have, but you have a few one out there. So in the fifth layer, you still have a few out there, but basically most of them are, yeah, I mean, a few that are wrong, but they next to each other, and the way it's just
probably not closing. They're slightly too far away for to be called in contact. So this is somehow how machine learning can help in this problem. The other people now they're doing more advanced things, but they are basically the same.
And this was just to show what we did how I did on machine learning. So we actually was used, it's called a random forest. So this is another machine learning method that actually puts rules. So basically says, hey, if this one is no, I mean basically it invents this kind of rules and you do it many times. So we should have a contact here, and then I should have it here, and they follow these rules. If it's a PLM, this way, this one is lower than that, if this one has this, and this one has that, and this one has this, and it's kind of complicated rules.
But I mean, the machine do it themselves, but we don't have to do it. And the reason we used random forest was because it was actually fast, and it worked quite well, and other methods just took too long, and it did better results, basically. I thought we would do what's called deep learning nowadays, but we didn't have that running now. And this was just showing that it worked better.
So this was just actually probably the first really impressive blind prediction of using this method. It was from the Baker, who makes Rosetta. And the Baker is a big guru in this field. I mean, he didn't do this first thing on his quantum predictions, but he was really his Rosetta program is widely used. Well, not he, but he was one of his students. But. So what they do is that they basically put in this contest and do folding with Rosetta. So Rosetta was this we put in fragments, but you just do the same thing again, but then you take also these constraints as an extra energy, these contacts.
And their contact method is called Gremlin. It's basically the same as PLMDCA, but it's called Gremlin.
And then the problem with the Rosetta sometimes is that if you have big proteins like this one, it's quite so big, but it's a few hundred residues. You get things that are not, I mean, see, I think one is the native structure, one is wrong, and they're not really nicely, they're not perfect in all sense, but they are, you have basically difficult to get stuck in local minima, so it's not very good for very big proteins. So you use another version called Rosetta CM that basically takes part of it and combines it together, so you can get something that looks like that. And then this was done in CASP. We had this protein structure prediction competition, and of course you have a limited amount of time to do it. So that's why you keep on doing this as many times as you can until either the deadline is reached or convergence, because the convergence means that basically nothing changed. So like if you use Cyblast, if you run Cyblast until convergence, well, if you don't find any new hits in each round of Cyblast, there's no reason to continue because it's going to be the same thing again. And here basically if you keep on doing this and the structure doesn't change anymore, I mean this Rosetta C method, where basically I don't know exactly how it works, but I think basically you take parts of the different models and put them together. Then you're done. And actually what it did was basically after the deadline. They kept it running a bit longer, and they have a model that is better, and because it's better because the DDTF, which is another measure of similarity, is goes from 0 to 1, so that basically 1 is identical, 0 is completely random, and then they had a better model, but also had a lower energy. So here they were in CASP, but then they just kept running it another time after the deadline, and end up there. So this was RMSD, so the difference was 2.6 angstrom, which means that, I mean, of course 2 angstrom is more than a bond length, but basically it's for a visual point of view it's very similar, but it's probably not good enough for doing docking and like that. And this is 0.68. You also see there are a few models that are slightly better, but they have slightly higher energies, but it's not a big difference. And then they have done this in a number of other problems later, and other people have done it also. So I think in the slide they have this paper published this year, but it published 600 structures that are probably in this order of quality. So there really has been a large scale prediction of protein structures that
everything suggests that they are more or less correct. But of course they're not really crystallographic resolution yet, they're really quite close to it.
Okay.
I do what I can, I go through them.
So the idea of all these initial models is that you do it when you cannot do homology model. So basically, it's the whole idea, if you can do homology modeling, you will do it. But if you cannot do homology modeling, you can't really... you can't really, there's no real reason to do that.
Which method is more trustworthy? I'm not really sure what you refer to there. The Marx paper is, I mean, it's a few years old, so I think the method for quantum prediction they use is called DCA, it was the original one. And it's PLM, DCA, and Gremlin are improvements on it. It's not a huge difference, but they are clearly better on average, and they use those nowadays. So there has been some quite significant improvements. And at the moment, I think the best methods are the ones that use combination of these DCA methods with machine learning. They are not only our methods, there are other methods around also. That's one called. Well, I think Raptor X is one of the better ones.
Sorry, can you say again, what
machine learning is? So the best method, I think, today that basically are similar in ideas what we do with PCON C3 or C2. If you combine some DCA type methods, in this case we do something called GDCA and PNDCA, with some other methods that are not DCA based. And then you do some kind of machine learning here. And there are several methods that do similar thing. One is called Metapsychov. That is from David Jones. So, the idea is very similar. And our method was the first one published, but the others are probably slightly better today. Yes, they have. This is the. Methods. It is very similar idea. So it basically takes three methods, CCM, PRED, PCI, probably DCA, and combine them together with a neural network. It really doesn't have this iteration, but it's probably more efficient, so that's probably okay. And then there's another method now called something deepfake, something like that is pretty good also. That's probably a method. But the idea is similar. They are, these are probably the best methods today for quantum predictions. They're probably better than Gremlin or L-shape P, I think I explained this. Why 50%? That's just what they did. It's just the details for the first paper. I'm not sure what they're doing more. I guess it was.
My question is, yeah. Why is it smaller than 50% and not larger?
Well, because basically in principle you don't want to have, I mean, it's probably from the way the test is. So basically if you have more than 50% secret identity, you probably have homologies, then you probably should use homology modeling instead. But of course if you really want to if you decide to do this and you have a test approach that has more than 50% secrecy, it's probably better to use it, yes, to have something bigger. I think this is probably from the way they tested it. So they made sure that you have no. This is probably the database. And this is probably when they make a database of structures that they don't want to have two problems that are too similar in the database. So they take all structures they take the structures that are 2.5 angstrom resolution. They are good structures. They only take, if there are many structures of the same thing, so you have the same sequence or similar sequences, you only take one representative structure. So it's basically homology reduction. So you don't want to have 10 copies of myoglobin, because they all look the same, and then your database will be very biased against towards myoglobins.
So this is
the fragment library, it's not the fragment...
So that refers to how they construct the library, how you select them.
But normally you wouldn't find anything that has high sequence identity. Well, sure, it can be 9 residues level, of course it can be high sequence level, because you would not use it if you have homology.
So once you find that homology, then you just go strict to homology.
Yeah, that's normal, yeah.
But when you research, you don't really restrict yourself to...
No, for yourself, if you have 3 residues, of course, they can be the same. It's obvious, because they can only... certainly, at least many cases, 2 out of 3 will be the same. So, yeah. So this is not for searching. And I'm sure that this is from the original paper 10 years ago, 15 years ago, so I'm sure they've changed with those nowadays. So small dihedral angle change in high resolution Rosetta. So basically that, take the 5 psi angles, and you're probably just 1 degree, 2 degrees, something like that. I don't know exactly what number they have, but it's very small numbers. And so it's basically just to some small changes, because the big idea is not that you change very much the backbone, it's that you can actually end up with slightly different sidechain packing. Because it might be, after the sidechain repacking, it might be bigger of the mineralization, but basically you're just trying to not change the structure a lot, but just shake it around a little bit to see if you can get better packing of the sidechains and better models. So it's mainly to, not so much to change the structure, it's mainly to obtain a better energy description. So what you do is basically, you know, small chains, and then you repack all the sidechains and you evaluate the energy again. So of course, if the sidechains are should be like that, that can happen. But there's a small random change in the backbone.
Like you try to optimize the. Yeah. It's like we saw in the folding at home, that one, so there are some
tweaking. Yeah. But you don't need to unfold it. In folding at home, you basically need to unfold and come back. So what you do here is basically you keep it more or less the same here. But by repacking the side chains, that sort of unpacking can happen again.
And then you calculate the
energy. Yes. So it's like the structure chain is very small, but the energy can be much better if you can pack the side chains much better. So you might, so if you go back to things like that, you might have something that is up here. It has a very high energy, but then small chains maybe brings it down here. So that is like a way, because of course the main problem with these energies is that you have 2 atoms cannot be in the same place. So if you really do simulations, you can't pass through one atom to another one. But if you just rebuild them, that can happen. I mean, they don't pass, but you can change the orientation of them. So that's the sort of the idea. Exactly what rules to have for changing this. I had to read the paper, I don't remember. So this is somehow the whole idea of Rosetta, that you can separate the local and global. I mean, if you look at history of how people believed that protein folds, in the beginning, as I think I said in the secondary structure prediction, people had the idea that maybe you have helices form first or sheets form first and then they come together. But if you look at experimental studies of protein folding, that's not the case. Because it's really hard to observe. I mean, you can do studies on what parts fold first, you know, and that is not the case. What happens is that often hydrophobic groups come together, because that's the driving force. What happens first probably is that you have local preference. If you have something that wants to be in helix, that can maybe share, or something that wants to be sheets, you have some local preferences. So that is kind of formed quite fast. Then you have this idea, and then this comes together with the global hydrophobicity packing term. And uh, So the idea in Rosetta is that you somehow, before people try to simulate all this at once, so like you do in microdynamics, you simulate, you have some MDG term that should both describe this local preference and the global preference. If you look at the folding at home video, they really had the preference of, I mean, you could come together and you have to unfold and come back and try many times. The Rosetta idea is somehow that you have at least some parts of the protein have a strong local preference. So the local conformations precedes and guide global conformations. So basically, have a local preference there. At least some parts of the protein are forming first. And then you can pack these global structures together. It's not obvious that that's really what happens in reality, but that's at least what Rosetta thinks it works. So the native-like global properties is basically, I wonder how to fall big core and how to feel like an outside. That's the main driving force. There are some other terms also, but that's the main thing. So actually what is important for this is that basically you can skip some details of the energy function. Because you have these kind of local fragments, you don't have to have an exact description of a hydrogen bond term in a helix, for instance. Because you know if something that really wants to be in a helix, it's going to be in a helix. So and if you can skip some of these properties, you're going to, I mean, there are fewer terms optimized. Otherwise, all the weight is against each other and do other things. So it gets more complicated. So instead, you kind of skip some of the details of local preferences and only focus on more global terms. So it probably makes the energy term easier. And that's probably one reason why Rosetta works quite well. Some plots of the contact maps. So in general, I think our contact maps are, I think they use the same color. I think some reason I do some green dots, I don't really know what they are actually. So the idea here is that this gray is always the native context. So these are the contacts that occur here, and you see, I don't know, they're not marked, but everything in this contact here is like a helix here, is a contact where these sheets together contact. A blow contact, is, so then I think in every, all these contact maps, we predict, we show you 260 or 270 top contacts, so one contact per residue. It's just, I mean, of course, everything else can be predicted, it's just we have to rank them by the top ones. So it's the same number of contacts shown in red and blue in every case. And in red are just the ones that are wrong, and blue are the ones that are correct. So basically, there are everything that overlap a gray one is blue, and everything that doesn't overlap a gray one is red. So that's contact maps, the idea. So if you look at this layer I had later, but here the color changed, but it's not blue, it's green and red. But here you see that this one is wrong, because I guess if you look at the other side, it's probably this one here, there's no contact there. I would assume it's that one. But that could be just it, man. There's always the cutoff. So a correct contact is 8 angstrom, it's 8.1 is wrong, if it's 7.5 is correct. So. They're still quite close, but they're not, maybe they're not exactly in the right spot.
So just, the color just means that it's bright. And
wrong, yeah. So this one doesn't exist. There's no gray hidden here behind here, but there is a gray hidden behind that one.
So you basically see that it overlap with the gray
area. Yeah. So that's a way to call it. And we always ignore the contacts that are, I think, less than 5 residues away from each other. So this one's down here, we ignore, because they are. I mean, everything is, of course, in contact with next residue. So these are some, for some reason, these are gray here. I don't think they were gray in the other plots. Here you see this white band here. I think it's 5 residues normally. And for some reason, we have some green dots. I don't really know why we have green there. I can't remember.
How about the layer?
Yeah, so this was our machine learning here. We have the treaty contact. We use this for this random forest, and we do it many times, or 5 times normally. So here, basically, this is the original predictions layer series. That's the original predictions we have. So that is what the predictions we have here. is this layer 0. And then for each, then we take the same data, but we take these predictions. So we have a prediction saying, then we ask, is this a correct or incorrect contact? We take this 11 by 11 window around it, so 5 residues in each direction around it, and ask what are the values that predict when all these 121 possible contacts. And then we ask, is this a good contact or not? And in this case, I guess it was a good contact because we never kept it. But it may be some case like, if I find some example, this one disappears.
So the score gets lower
because this one was not predicted to be a good contact. And we do this several times, and each time it gets slightly better. It's not a bit, I mean, 3 or 5 layers doesn't really matter. Somewhere a few layers improves things. So it's just demonstrate how this machine learning method works.
Could I have a small break?
Sure. Let's take 10 maybe. We've done that. It seems that PCON33 is an important concept of the lecture, but I didn't find enough information on the internet. Well, the paper is not published yet, so that can explain it. I can put it on the web page. But well, it's hopefully published soon, but it's not published yet. I think the web server works. But it's a bit slow, but it should work. I don't know if
I click reference.
Yeah, do we have references? Yeah, it's there. Mm-hmm. Also, it's not, I have it here, but I can actually put it on the web.
Okay.
It's not, I can do that. Okay, so that's the reason I can add it here in a second. If it works. What is so funny?
Now we have to share the whole class.
Now it's there. So that was the easy thing to fix. Please go through everything important. Okay, I will go through everything important that will not occur on the exam. No. Important concepts. I think there is some important concepts that are. And some of the nice things are these kind of movies that are so basically. This is not the course about molecular mechanics. There's a later course about molecular mechanics much more. So you don't need to know. There's a lot of things to know about. But of course, the idea with an MD simulation is that it should represent what happened in nature. It should be a native thing. And
So the best idea we have about how it proves false is probably from these type of simulations. And also from experiments, but they kind of agree. And today, the problem is, of course, that folding is too slow, and probably energy functions are not probably accurate enough really to fold proteins on that are not some extreme cases of rapid folders, that are very, very fast folding proteins. So that is, I think, a key concept. The other key concept is people have done methods such as Rosetta, and many other methods. People have worked on this since the 70s on like trying to make method of structure prediction and using different simplifications. And the only thing that really, Rosetta sort of worked, but it was not very, it worked in some cases. It was always worked better for alpha helical proteins, but it worked in other cases also. There are a number of successful stories about Rosetta. And basically, the only case you know when it works is basically when you end up with running it many times and end up with the same structure every time, or many times at least. It's a basic case like this. And it's almost impossible to know when you have a case like this or not. So you try to simulate running it thousands of times, and if you end up with the same or very similar low energy conformation every time, then you're most likely correct. But in some cases, you just end up with one structure like that, then one structure like that, then one like that, then one like that, and you have no idea if energies are correct. And it's always, and it works for quite small proteins, not for big proteins. And you need a lot of computer powers. And then, of course, what happened, then, of course, the next thing that is important is basically is the whole idea of quantum predictions. I said this happened in the last 5-6 years, and as you said, it's an important progress. Suddenly, you can apply this large scale with high accuracy, which you couldn't do before. So I think I have in the paper and on the slide, I think I put up this paper from Baker this year. This is the metagenomic paper. So he had several papers around, but I picked this one because it was the latest one. And so here they present actually 600 structures of things that are not known before. Yes, show a few. I mean, they don't present all of this here, but they show it here. And I mean, the only thing really fundamentally interesting here is basically that they use a bigger sequence database. The other parts they have published before. But this allows them, I think they have an eLife paper that published about 100 or maybe 200 structures. The difference in that actually try to go through all these 100 structures and try to describe the biology of them, which is probably took much more time than the running all. It's like, well, what do you do with 100 structures? And these papers, they don't really do that. They have, at least except for a few cases. So these are some cast parts, which are some transporters, some membrane proteins.
And what did they do with all these 600 new structures?
They're probably available to download.
I mean, like, did they do a library of it?
Yeah, I'm sure they are. I'm not sure if they are in PDB. I don't know. Would be interesting. I probably can read. So something. Deposit maybe. I find a deposit section. They don't really say so in the PDB, so I'm not sure. David Baker. At least they're not in PDB yet.
When was it published?
A month ago, more than 3 weeks ago. Yeah, no, I mean, it's this year. It's one of the first issues this year, so. Not more than a month ago.
And there's
I don't know. No, I'm not sure what PDB will do it, because PDB has. I'm not sure what they actually would do. So it's not clear to me what they do. I mean, they are basically, they have some quality criteria, quality checks, what is the answer to those, and I have no idea how they deal with these things, because I think they never really bother about it. But it seems like the eLife structures are not there yet. They're probably not in PDB. There are other databases or models in that. I'm sure you can download it from the database homepage. That's not the problem. If you go to, so I'm sure you can find them, but I don't. They seem not to be in PDB yet. Stuff, David. Being in Sweden in June, I know. There, you got this one. So this is this Sergei Ovnishnikov, who done all this work. Yeah, so I'm sure it's somewhere. Yeah, proven structure models, probably you can do it out there. So here you can get the whole list of all the PDB files. This is the contact map, as you have known somewhere. And this is our model, okay. Somewhere they have, you can download it if you want. The problem is, of course, is like what, I'm sure if you're working on a protein, on one of these proteins, you want to know something, you probably download it and look at it. But it takes, of course, some manual work to figure out if it really contains any information that's interesting or not. And I'm sure that some of the models are wrong, but most likely not that many. So that I think the whole idea of this quantum prediction is important, and it's part because we work on it. But I think it has been there are a lot of earlier work, and basically the only thing that sort of worked was Rosetta. So we probably should have an idea what Rosetta does, and that's if you want to learn something about protein. Let's put up this link also. If you want to learn something about protein structures, you should actually have played this game Folded. This one. Have you seen that? Yeah. So that is a protein game where you try to fold proteins basically using Rosetta. But you do, instead of having the computer doing all the changes, you do it themselves. So you can basically try and you can optimize things. It's quite good for actually understanding how. What is energies and things like that in a protein?
But wouldn't that take much more time?
No. It takes time, but it's a game. And then, of course, I have never passed more than level 3 of this game because I'm not very good at this. But
I mean, would it be more effective to do it like on the computer, like a program?
Maybe humans can take. There are a lot of people good at playing games, and some of them have actually come up with smart things. So they have. They claim to have used it for a number of cases where it actually matters, but I'm not sure that's true. But
what about the AI? Wouldn't that work instead?
No, maybe. But AI, someone has to do it. It's not.
Yeah, no, someone has to do it, but I mean, like.
You can probably. But it's a good. I think it's mainly good educational tool. I'm sure if I have it installed, but.
And it's free?
Yeah.
So after you have solved one folding, you send it to them?
There are categories like it. I never got that far in it. I don't have it, I think. It's still called beta. There was money. I can't even log in here.
But do they know the correct folding?
Not in all cases, they're used for many things. You can play.
It's not like they give you an unknown protein and ask you to fold it.
There are cases like that, yes.
They are, okay.
So they have used it in CASP for that.
If I have folded, it's not have fold.
No, there's nothing else. No, but I can put up a link on it. It's a fun thing if you want to learn about protein structures. I think it's quite good for. For actually understanding energy for the proteins. That's what I think it's useful for. I'm just convinced that it's very useful for. For actually pretty structures, there's nothing more doubtful about. But it's I guess you can look at the video and it probably serves or something. No.
Or if you go to YouTube, there's for this video.
So they have competition, you have rank, we are, and you're trying to move these two things together to each other, I think, by, I don't know what you do it. Yeah. And you can pull the one part here, and you can pull it there, and you can have the energies.
And it's like you get as possible.
Yeah, in the beginning it was just, it's just to put things together, and that's how far I got, and then I failed. Basically, in this case, it managed to get some nice structure out of it. It's kind of fun if you want to spend time on it. Okay, so these are, I think, the important concepts. Is there something I missed? I have a slide that I'm sure we can skip them. Oh, I'm almost out of battery. I need to stop my recording, I think.